Red Moon Roleplaying in association with Adventure Hook Podcast proudly present a Black Spire Studios renditions of the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons 2nd Edition Classic Planescape Adventure to Beator and Back, which we've lovingly subtitled Hell is Other People. This episode contains themes and situations that may be offensive to some audiences. Listener discretion is advised. Hi there, I'm Hjalmar Norden from Red Moon Roleplaying, but tonight I am Maje, Dante Harkadies, the Fractured One. A human specialist wizard focusing on conjuration, fittingly known as the Swarmer. To Beator and Back, Episode 3, In That Sleep of Death, Lucid. Magic is both an art and a science, and I have mastered each approach in turn. Time and again, I have proven how I am a paragon example of my bloodline's famous talent for wielding arcane power. Top of my class at the Academy of War Magic, received special appointment via dispensation from the Grand Arbiter himself to a post within the Royal Wizards of Navulon. One of the finest summoners in King Daemon's court, the other war mages have come to call me the Swarmer because of my reputation for bringing my own army to every battle that I wage, a reputation that no doubt precedes me. Gods above and below us, if only it were deserved. In truth, in all the many years since we last parted ways, Finnett Pickard had never really been far from my mind. I'd heard the Inquisition chased him halfway across the world, but he still managed to stay one step ahead and ultimately escape them. Whenever I pull out the Archmage's Anthology in my attempts to study it again, and I see that strange cityscape sketched on the book's inside cover, I find myself wondering about whatever became of Finnett. Naturally, I graduated at the top of my class at the Drakesmark Academy of War Magic, finally earning the rank of Magi. And thanks to Aunt Marge pulling some strings, I quickly found my appointment to the Royal Wizards, like I'd always dreamed. Inside of a year, I had become casual friends with Prince Daemon II himself, and, as I'd wanted since I was a boy, would be invited along on his royal hunting trips. I regularly curried the prince's favor by always being able to scare up a quarry whenever the game seemed scarce. What does it matter if those animals were all secretly produced by my magical bag of tricks? The prince was pleased with me, and that was all that mattered. As was the custom of the Drakesmoor kings, the worthiest son would take up the ancestral sword, Navulon, and seek experiences abroad that would make him a better king. 'Twas the sword itself that would choose its bearer, and lend its wisdom and counsel, and occasionally even its magic, to every matter of import to the prince. However, while I was in the sword's presence, on numerous occasions, I never once saw the bearded face on the sword's hilt ever actually talk to anyone. Since his youth, the prince had always adventured with his closest comrades, two of them who I also came to know in time over various royal hunts. The first was the young elf prince, Dolathin Kithrel, of the Sapphire Unicorn tribe. The king of the elves had sent his great nephew to be fostered in Navulon, and there he pursued the study of both the martial and magical arts with equal discipline, and was even made an honorary member of the Royal Wizards. Prince Daemon's other loyal companion was the violet-bearded dwarf Thordin Ironbeard. The dwarf was also a noble of sorts, as the Ironbeards had once been great kings of the dwarves of Niflheim, but long ago, mind. However, Thordin had set aside his familiar duties when he joined the Grudge Keepers of Khazad-dûr and took oaths to right the wrongs done to his people. Many trials did these three overcome together, and by night, the taverns of Navulon were filled with songs of their exploits. During their many adventures, Prince Daemon met and fell in love with the mermaid princess, Arilyn. Was it Arilyn? Well, theirs was a scandal of some great intrigue, and perhaps an opportune one. The merfolk of Mulantia and the sailors of Navulon had long been at odds, and so the prince's betrothal to the mermaid princess promised both nations a new era of peace. After many years spent among the royal wizards, I had begun to foster quite the reputation as a battlefield summoner. Conjurers must forego all that fire and lightning sort of magic, and so thusly, invokers must equally avoid the school of conjuration, and since practitioners of my field were always more sparse, there was always a place for my expertise. Even though the closer my responsibilities brought me to the crown, further my ties to my family became. I still maintained cordial, if infrequent, social contact with Great Aunt Maje. I'd made a home and a life for myself in the Royal Wizards of Navulon, and it was through no desire of my own that I came to distance myself somehow from my academy-entrenched Harkadies family. Even the troubles in lands beyond, like the Titanic Dragon Civil War, or Prince Daemon II suddenly leaving to investigate a prophecy Princess Arilyn believed would befall her people, did little to dampen my spirits. At all times, though, I still did long to understand those deeper mysteries of reality that elude even the Academy thinkers. If only I could find someone who truly understood to explain it all to me. Then the day came, quite recently, when King Daemon called a special joint meeting of the wizards and the Academy leadership. In a flurry of commotion, it was revealed that one of the royal wizards had recently been defeated in a formal duel by none other than the traitor and fugitive Lord Finnet Pickett himself, who had returned to Navulon for some unknown reason. And the king aimed to learn what that reason was. The local constabulary lost Pickett's trail near the borders of the Surfless Hills, and apparently the heretic's infamous reputation was now of such legendary degree that the king felt obligated to include the papal inquisition in Finnet's initial capture. When the royal wizards were asked to appoint an emissary to bring this information to the Holy City and lead the Pope's expedition, it was actually my dear great aunt Maje who boldly suggested that I, Lord Dante Harkadies, was the only one of their numbers to have actually known Lord Pickett by more than just reputation.
No doubt,
she boasted.
The Swarmer needs no men beyond his trusty falcon. He and he alone could admirably represent both the Royal Wizards and the Academy of War Magic in this official regard.
Daemon Drakesmore I, the Sovereign King of Navulon, was inclined to agree. This task seemed far outside my usual responsibilities of hunting with the royal family, but duty demanded I accept the assignment. However, King Daemon, to me privately, also insisted that I do my best to keep this incident as quiet as possible. Lord Finnet is considered an embarrassment to the whole Pickett family, as well as to the kingdom at large and its various institutions, and so the king doesn't want a spectacle made of him. I've been ordered to make it a priority to learn who it was that Finnet met while he was in Navulon, and why. But that it is even more important that the members of the church also assigned to the mission find out as little as possible in this regard, particularly any information pertaining to Navulonian noble families. Otherwise, the king said I was to aid the Inquisitors, however I could, in apprehending Lord Pickett, and defer to their jurisdiction in administrating any justice. But I was made to understand it would be better for everyone if Finnet were dead, rather than to be let out of my sight. Or worse, fall into the notorious hand of the papal interrogators of the White Cathedral and be put to the question. If the Inquisition should prove itself incapable of safely securing their prisoner, I may then secure Finnet myself and escort the fugitive to the city of Drakesmark personally. Otherwise, by order of the king, under no circumstances is Finnet Pickett to reach the holy city alive. I made my way quickly to the Theocracy of Solon, and there had the privilege of delivering the news of Finnet Pickett's reappearance to Pope Zealous XV himself. After assuring His Holiness that King Drakesmore had no interest in administering justice to this heretic, the Pope quickly assembled a force to capture their long-eluded quarry, which, as it turned out, was a contingent of over 20 temple guards, under the command of a dragon knight named Sir Milton Vespers, and led by one of the Theocracy's most famous inquisitors, an eight-fingered man by the name of Virgil St. Froskis, had apparently been chasing Finnet since the original Drakesmark Academy debacle. It appears that Finnet Pickett was the only person ever able to evade capture by St. Froskis, and he managed to do it in more than one occasion. During our journey to the Surfless Hills, I was able to learn from the least suspicious of the Temple Guardsmen that the Paladin Sir Milton, he was once a decorated member of the elite Papal Dragon Guard. A veteran of sorties launched during the Dragon Civil War, his dragon mount was killed in some famous battle, and the man's apparently never been the same since. Having a falcon familiar myself, and knowing the ties that I have made with it, I think I understand his feeling of loss. The Inquisitor is another matter, and seems even more leery of my arcane abilities than I had expected a devout, fanatical sun worshipper to be. The Inquisitor's emblem, a golden skull in a fiery sunburst, does little to ease my apprehension about the man who, if it weren't for the fact that he is a royal wizard on personal assignment by King Daemon himself, would probably like nothing better than to burn me at the stake as a heretic, right beside old Finnet. We led the temple soldiers to the edge of the Surfless Hills, a mountainous territory unfortunately positioned between both the Theocracy and Navulon, but because of the shadow of the titanic world tree, like some great sundial, because that shadow falls across those lands at certain times of the year, it is agreed upon by all the surrounding nations to be included in the pagan territory of the Druids, and thus no one else would officially try to lay claim to it. I thought it best then to engage the services of a local druid, an elf who goes by the name of Brother Mark Maple, to be our guide through the untamed rough country. Admittedly, our trek through the trackless wilderness and subsequent stops to camp was a bit more rustic of an experience than I was typically used to. But the druid's casual familiarity with all the beasts of the wild certainly impressed me. I happily followed the elf's woodland advice, and so managed to avoid the worst of the elements. With Brother Mark Maple's expert guidance, we were able to follow the telltale signs of Lord Pickett's passing, which, based on how the druid explained it, was simply following along a ley line of fire energy, until at last we came upon an ancient buried structure, that showed evidence of Arcusian architecture that clearly dated back thousands of years. Obviously built by an elementalist of some type during some bygone age, clearly no one had lived in this structure for centuries. And yet, even before Solaris dipped behind the colossal branches of the impossibly tall world tree to bathe the entire mountain range in shadow, I could distinctly make out the smoke from a charcoal fire rising from the apex of the mound. My old school chum, Finnet, was inside. And, as that great shadow falls, like it or no, a class reunion was about to take place. The class reunion with my old schoolmate Finnet proved itself to be horrific from the very start, and only descended into abject hell from there. No, literal hell, in fact. Whether he truly meant it or no, Lord Pickett has dragged all of us to the nine hells with him, and somehow has perhaps saved us from an even worse fate in the process. The impossible sights I have gazed upon since arriving at this place, repulsive as they are fascinating, beautiful as they are dangerous, defy any true attempts to describe them. I think it would be an easy thing indeed for a man to lose his mind here. I can't possibly be the first. We must find a way out of this place, and quickly. Finnet must have a plan.
There is no night, and no day, in the Nine Hells. Only the featureless crimson sky, streaked with the countless columns of black, acrid smoke. Evidence of the countless fiery explosions that randomly announce the reports from horizon to horizon. The air is uncomfortably hot, but the steady, scorching winds are downright painful and carry on them the sound of distant, tortured screams. Atop an eerie plateau along the rim of a titanic stone maw, we see a group of men, strangers to this realm most foul, as well as a small, spiny devil that has recently made their acquaintance. As the men gape in awe and horror at the hellscape vision that greets them, the devil continues down the tongue. They have all just descended towards a large signal horn made of bone and bronze, suspended impossibly in midair by a strange iron bar. What now do you gentlemen do?
So, Sir Milton, I'm looking up at the crimson sky. I keep looking for Solaris, keep looking for some solace here. This place is making me grow concerned. I feel responsibility for the men under my command here as well. I really had wished that they would not have had to come with here, but now they are my responsibility, and I must make sure to bring them home, and to also find our quarry, and make sure that he is brought to justice. However, I'm going to do that, though, will be an interesting challenge.
Indeed, indeed. But tell me, Sir Milton, after all these years, do you even bother to learn the names of the men who serve under you anymore? Do you know these men's names?
I do not. I have seen so many die. But it has been a cost of war. War must be fought sometimes. It is the price that we pay for our faith, and there are sacrifices that must be made, but lately I have started to feel like my faith is perhaps shaken a bit, and it is not that everything is permitted, really. There are things important in this world as well, and I believe that life perhaps matters more than faith. I do not know. I am lost at times. I wish I could find my way back to the person that I was before, the Dragon Knight, who was so sure of what he was doing.
Yes.
I say as I touch the pendant.
Yes, your pendant, but also your sword. That too, you feel its absence, don't you?
Yes.
It used to guide you, one way or another, and now it has fallen silent. What does Milton make of that?
It is an unbearable feeling. I feel ashamed. I have done something wrong. I know that, but I know not what. I do feel ashamed, though. But this journey, what we do here, yes, this will be a way to redeem myself. The sword, it told me as much. It approved of what I was doing. Mm. Yes, I must follow the course here.
Very well, very well. As we turn to Inquisitor Virgil, what do we see him doing at this moment?
I am looking around me, looking at the sky, looking at the earth. I'm no fool. I've had quite some time now to acknowledge that my god is not here. It does make sense. I am aware a little of the dimensions of the planes, not so much in an arcane sense, but in a religious sense, I would of course be aware that the domains of our gods do not extend everywhere. There are reasons for that. Still, it is troubling, but I have to persevere. I have to focus on what I can do, not on what I can't do. I do inadvertently have my man. The need to capture, the need to apprehend is slightly mellowed, knowing that he is here and doesn't seem to be going anywhere else anytime soon, as long as I keep an eye on him. Also, I admit, having spent so much time around him now, my expectations have been altered. I've always imagined the typical witchmaster, the typical occultist, so proud, so arrogant of their ways, and yet I am confronted now with a wretch, a coward, all his scheming simply to avoid punishment from his superiors. I certainly, perhaps not pity, but maybe I feel that he doesn't need to be burned as quickly as I used to think. No, unfortunately, I need him. And perhaps he has a use yet. If what he says is true, and I'm starting to believe it may well be, he may be instrumental in saving our realm, whether he wishes to save our realm or not.
What about Maje Dante Harkadies? What would we see him doing at this moment?
I glance up at the sky and I see Nyx, my falcon, my familiar and my friend, riding these strange winds up there. No doubt being a bit confused about this place that we're in.
Yes, confused, scared even. This is unfamiliar and You would know that, animals have a more particular or perhaps a closer relationship with Terragastia and the Earth than perhaps mortal men, experience. And your bird, you get the sense of disconcertion.
Definitely. So he doesn't fly as high and soar as he used to back home. He's surprisingly close to me, but I guess I shouldn't be surprised, really. I feel almost the same way. It's this sort of mix between fascination and yet horror of this place. Why couldn't Finneth have brought us to a more pleasant realm if we were supposed to be just taken away from this imminent destruction of our world? I'm sure he had his reasons, and I glance over at him and see his sort of emaciated self, what he's turned into. My former, well, study partner. I'd always almost like to call him friend, though it's been such a long time, and I'm not quite sure if he's been driven mad, or if there's actually truth to what he says.
Perhaps a bit of both. But as we turn to look at Lord Finot Pickett, what would we see him doing?
Internally, Finot is still chafing against being called Filton by the Inquisitor who has been chasing him for so many years, couldn't even learn his name correctly. It stabs at his ego. His fascination for where he is kind of supersedes as he crests the rim of the pit and comes out upon this plateau. He's more inquisitive about the space. He bends down and grabs a handful of soil and begins to sort of examine its composition. Kind of pushing the soil around, and then kind of lets it filter out through his fingers, and he looks up and he sniffs the air. What is that? Ozone? What are those smells? Interesting. Looking at the rocks, at the horizon, kind of lost in this new realm that he's experiencing. Off to the side where you could see in the distance that host engaged in some massive struggle, perhaps. Wondering.
It's difficult from this distance to tell, but yes, looking down this to the bottom of this sort of sweeping plateau that you find yourself on top of, there's a large red and orange dusty plain, and you can see masses of shapes milling about in that haze, though. And also, even above it, you see winged figures, many, many winged figures flying back and forth, to and fro, in and out of these columns of black smoke. And perhaps, is that even impossibly the silhouette of a dragon? Is there on the horizon? It's difficult to tell.
You can see Finet, he's kind of his fingers kind of run across his lips as he kind of wonders and thinks aloud. Could that be? Is it perhaps? No. Interesting.
Do I see this dragon as well?
Yes, I would say that after a few moments, I mean, you were all probably just staring slack-jawed in awe and horror at the scene before you, and all the while, too, you are, actually, we should point out, you men are also accompanied by, a handful, I believe at this point, five temple soldiers from the, Church of Solaris. They are, well-trained, disciplined soldiers dressed in, bronze plate mail, carrying shields and morning stars that are shaped like the sun. But the men, of course, while they are disciplined and Sir Milton has managed to keep them in line, they are, of course, terrified. And they cannot seem to take their eyes off, also, this spiny little devil who is moving away from your group, down along this, like, tongue that continues out of this large, large maw towards what, like I said, it appears to be some sort of signal horn hovering in midair at the end of this tongue, just sort of floating there. And he seems to be making his way in that direction, sort of laughing at you all the while.
Claw those crabs. Got some bricks that I don't even know where they've happened to.
And he's just sort of laughing to himself and chuckling, enjoying your, sort of yokel-like experience in his mind.
Not wanting him to get too far ahead, fearing perhaps an ambush, I pick up the pace a little bit while I'm at the same time throwing in an eye towards the sky there, towards that thing that looked like it might have been a dragon.
Well, which is it, though? Do you... I mean, you can't see the dragon at this moment. It may have disappeared behind this column of smoke. Do you want to let the devil go and continue to watch, or do you want to ignore the skies and focus on the devil?
Faced with that choice, I just shake my head and think, no, it cannot be. No, it's not possible, not here. No, that would not make sense. No, and I focus on the little devil. And I...
Okay, so you are attempting to cut him off? You could move faster than him if you wished.
I just want to stay close to him. I have no reason to believe that he has any ill will towards us. We have, after all, become friends through the power of the wine that I handed over. But I'm still wary.
Okay, well, as he notices you keeping pace with him, and he slows down, looks up in your direction.
Can I help you with something, Burke?
No. I just wanted to see where you were leading us.
Oh, I'm not leading you nowhere. You don't want to be up here. You want to be over there, remember?
And he points at the range of mountains far, far, far in the distance, many, many miles away.
He says, you don't need me no more.
I suppose we don't. But before I let you go, that horn there, what does that call forth?
Oh, don't worry about that. That's not for you guys. No. That's for me to signal in case we get invaded by somebody. But that's not what you guys are here to do, right?
No, we are not here for an invasion.
That's what I thought. So.
And almost as on cue, I would like Virgil and Sir Milton to each roll me another die four.
Four.
One. Okay. As you all are standing around, looking off in various directions or whatever, you are all immediately, your eyes are drawn back down to the crater once again, and you can see the magical circles flare to light again in glowing blue fire. The sigils ignite one last time, and five more of your temple soldiers come tumbling through the portal, screaming as they fall. And you even hear a blood-curdling scream that seems to be suddenly cut off.
Oh no, this is not good.
So there are five more men down in the circle. You have the devil at your left, or you could go back down the tongue, or you could shout some orders. What do you do, Milton?
Stay here, men. I will go see to our brethren and make sure that they get acclimatized to this new environment, I say, and I rush off towards them, wanting to reassure them and wanting them to not panic, like they would probably do otherwise.
Okay, well, Sir Milton, I would like you to make me a dexterity roll, and the rest of you, let me know what you would like to do.
How far away is the circle at this stage?
It is down this long stone tongue, which is at least 50 feet below the surface where you are, maybe even farther. So it is some distance between where you are now and where they are. You would have to basically run around the lip and back down the tongue to get back down there.
I have dexterity 14 and I roll a 5.
Okay, you are fine. You can keep your footing and make it down to the bottom of the tongue. Virgil, are you staying put or are you coming with?
I shall stay put only because I believe that he has this handled. I'm hoping... I keep an eye out, but I'm assuming he's simply going to get some men and join us. I'm a little impatient, but I will wait and keep an eye on Pickett.
All right, well, you're keeping an eye on Pickett, and Pickett and Dante, I assume you're keeping an eye on this devil. As Milton goes to leave, though, the devil seems to sort of start strolling towards that horn again.
I should just shrug, and I say... Oh, they'll catch up, and just stroll in the continued direction.
Okay, fair enough. All right, let's resolve this first. Sir Milton, you rush back down to the bottom of the crater. Make me a charisma roll just to get your men in order, but you'll probably make this.
I have charisma 17, and I roll a 19.
Oh, you fail. Okay, so you are failing. The men are panicked. They are all basically either screaming or, you know, gibbering madly, or one of them is pointing wide-eyed at a now quickly spreading pool of blood that seems to be collecting in the center of this circle. And you can see that there is an armored arm, just an arm, but a severed arm is lying there. One of your men's arms is lying there on the ground. And you do not see the man who is missing it.
Men, calm yourselves.
What's happened? Where are we, sir? What's going on, sir?
Calm yourself. Solaris will guide us. We will find our way home. We are just a little lost, that's all. We are in a strange place. But we are not alone. You are with us now, and we have more of our brothers with us. Find a way to calm yourself, please, man.
Okay.
Please.
All right. Well, they at least for this minute are going to be panicking. What about the rest of you up on the lip? What are you going to be doing about this little devil, if anything?
Finnet sidles up next to the little devil and basically says, "Invasion. You mentioned invasion. Do you speak of the blood war?"
"Not specifically, Cutter. But what do you know about the Blood War?"
"I know that the Blood War is the reason why my land is being cut off from the multiverse. Or at least the reason I was told."
"Well, yeah, I suppose you could say I'm a recruiter for the Blood War. Although that's pretty much what we all do, Burke."
"And this horn. Are you going to blow upon it?"
Not until you live.
"Okay.
You're in trouble, aren't you?"
Oh, by the way, he is speaking Infernal, or, High Necrossian, which I believe, I know Finnot speaks, I believe Dante, you speak as well, but I don't know if any of the other ones do.
I do not.
I do speak Necrossian, yes.
Mm-hmm. All right, so you can understand this conversation.
He says, "Are you guys having problems with that little tissues over there?"
And he points to the Inquisitor with the skull and sun badge.
Yeah.
And the flaming golden sword.
Yeah. I say, "Yes, he has been pursuing me for years now, and has finally caught me. I think if he learns the truth, he will kill us."
"Unfortunately, neither of these allies..."
And I'm speaking Infernal as well.
Okay.
"Yes, me too. I go on and I smile and I say, yes, unfortunately, these allies that I have brought with me are not something that I would prefer to have here at all."
"Or maybe I can help you, Burks."
Inquisitor Virgil, you notice these two wizards speaking to this devil in a language that you recognize as Necrossian, but you do not actually understand. What do you do?
I raise an eyebrow, and I just sort of stroll over and go, "Something we need to be talking about, friends?"
No. Let me ask you a question. You're a cleric, right?
Yes.
The rest of the gods and stuff?
I do.
That fancy sword on your belt there. That pretty gold sword that you got? Did the priests give you that one? Did your church give you that sword?
Did, indeed.
So what do they call that kind of sword?
This sword.
Sir, it's a hand and a half sword, right? Also known as a bastard sword.
Sort of, yes.
So tell me, Burke. Did they give you that sword because you only have one and a half hands? Or did they give it to you because you're a bastard?
I stifle a laugh, and I turn to St. Frostkiss, and I ask, "Yes, what is the story behind your fingers? Why have you just 8 fingers?"
"I actually consider the devil for a few seconds. I smirk. I remark, "You clearly are a being of great wit and intelligence." And to Dante, I say, "Frostbite." Hence the name.
Ah, I see. So did you have another name before this?
How creative. I guess we should expect that from a priest of Solaris. They're always so drab and dreary.
I did not coin the nickname myself, Finnet. It was given to me by my companions and elders.
I raise an eyebrow now. I'm a bit surprised that all of a sudden he calls Finnet by his real name. It's almost as if there's a change
perhaps,
of mood.
Perhaps. But speaking of changes of mood, Sir Milton, please roll me another charisma roll. See if you can get the men in order.
Yes, and I continue trying to convince them of the fact that while this is a tough situation, we are together, and I roll a 20.
You rolled a 20, so you failed again.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I'm going to say that your men are... These guys, for whatever reason, the magical transit or whatever has... Basically, they are essentially temporarily insane, at least. They are panicked. They are undisciplined. You can shove them and make them move, but you can't get them to, like, form ranks or anything like that.
Can
what,
I...
What do you want to do?
I, seeing the futility of any further action to try to calm them down, I decide that we shall leave them here, and we shall move on, and we shall come back for them later.
Okay, so these five men, at least, down here, you're leaving.
Yes.
The other ones up top, they are still, you know, basically staying with the Inquisitor. Does that mean that Milton returns to the lip?
It does indeed. Yes, I come back to them, to the men, and to the rest of the group. And
okay, well,
yes,
that sounds like a conversation between the Inquisitor and Sir Milton.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I move up to the Inquisitor.
I was going to say, as they come back up, can I see that the men with him are clearly disturbed and unhappy?
I would say yes. I would say you would hear them shouting and, you know, lamenting, screaming, tearing their hair out, that kind of stuff, you know.
I step forward and I begin to sing a hymn quite loudly. I do not sing one of the more traditional Solarian hymns that would be perhaps reserved for worship. Mm-hmm. I actually sing an older song that I knew from my childhood. And as you know, I used to know some more jovial songs once.
Yeah. You actually even know an elven tune or two, if you want to sing an elven.
Yes,
those
actually
are definitely the more calming of the lullabies, so to speak.
Yes, I shall begin singing an old elven song of Solaris, the theme largely being have faith and be strong, but perhaps slightly more familiar to common folk and also maybe a little less dour in style.
Sure, sure. Well, why don't you just roll me charisma?
Can I not roll, actually, it's the exact
below
same as my singing, so fair enough.
Oh, yeah, that's fine then. Yeah, yeah, roll singing. I'm sorry.
Because I've got performance orientation / singing.
Mm-hmm. Yes, you do.
13.
Okay, that succeeds, I believe, right?
Yes.
So I will say that that manages to actually calm the men down, almost supernaturally, you might say. All of you who would hear this would, with the exception perhaps of, you know, Lord Pickett, might find themselves even moved by it. Perhaps even Lord Pickett would find, his heartstrings tugged a little bit, perhaps. Perhaps. But regardless, what I will say is let's fast. Oh, go ahead.
Pickett wanted to do something as the Inquisitor began to sing.
Okay.
He would sidle up next to Dante and sort of in a hushed tone kind of speak out of the corner of his mouth in Infernal to Dante and have like a brief little conversation while he is singing. So
okay.
Basically he comes up beside Dante and says, "Why have you fallen in with this lot, Dante? We were friends once. We had similar goals. I feel betrayed."
"I know. I know, and I have missed our conversations direly. What has happened is that I am now one of the royal wizards of Navulon, and I was asked here by the king to see what you were up to, see who you had been meeting, because all I know is that you dueled one of the wizards of, well, the lands, one of the royal wizards, nonetheless. I had to find out why. I was sent only because I know you from before, and it is not my hope that you would be captured and brought back. Never, never would I, upon my life, would I see you brought back to the theocracy of Solon.
All right, at this point, I would say that the Inquisitor would be finishing up his song.
Okay.
So you would probably want to be careful about any additional conversations, but you could certainly have them. Yeah.
Well, we're speaking in Infernal.
Yeah, you're speaking in Infernal, yeah.
Yeah, so as he finishes, he just says, just know, I had no choice in that fight. I was forced by my uncle, Andonicus.
I know.
That individual had information about the Dark Alliance. They had to be quieted. I am sorry for what has happened, but sorry for bringing you here against your will, but we're on the verge. We're going to discover the secret math. It's in Sigil, I know. But briefly, before the Quizzer turns back, you must know, when he discovers that he is not going to be able to return to Terragastia, he will not only come after me, but he'll seek vengeance after you as well. He's already declared his intent that we both speak heresy. He will lump you with me. Just know.
I know. I understand. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, so at this point I would say that the group of men, all, you know, 25 of you, including the elven druid, who we actually been forgetting to talk about, but Brother Mark Maple, we'll say actually has returned from a brief scouting, and he basically comes back to report that he believes that he has found the safest way to at least begin your descent down the plateau.
I finish my song. I briefly remark to the men, know that while we are far from home, we are going to return home, or die in the attempt. And that is all you need to focus on, friends. And I will turn to this man, and then I will turn to Finnet, and Dante, Milton, and remark, shall we continue onwards?
Yes.
Yes, we shall. And I look up upon the Inquisitor with admiration. This truly is Solaris in person.
Interesting. Very well. So, what next, gentlemen?
Well, I would say we go in the direction that the little devil has pointed and follow Mark Maple's directions, you know, on his safe route down.
And there are, what about the rest of you? He basically, what we'll say is he's at this point has actually even flown to the tip of the tongue and is sort of sitting on this horn almost like it's a swing, basically trying to suck the last little bits of wine out of the bottle that Sir Milton had given him before he absentmindedly chucks it off the side of this cliff and watches you go, waving as you do. Is there anything that you wanted to do about that?
What I'm just saying, like, game terms, I'm keeping a close eye over my shoulder on the little devil as we begin to depart, because he's up on that horn, and he said he's going to wait till we're gone, but still, I don't know what that's going to summon, and I don't know what kind of range, you know, of danger we will be in once he does blow that horn. So, for right now, how far am I from him?
Well, I mean, you're really not all that far from him. Maybe, you know, 20, 30 feet. The difficulty, it appears, though, is he's on literally, like, the tip of this tongue, right? Which actually is almost, if you can imagine, almost like a cliff. Like it, or a promontory that sticks out over the edge of this, like, plateau, right? And it appears to be covered in some kind of weird green slime that he is flying over and not stepping on.
Hmm. Perhaps poison. Trap for any who would approach the horn.
Perhaps.
And
he is sort of sitting there, almost sitting in a swinging back and forth on this horn that is suspended from brass chains from an iron bar that just seems to be hovering there in space.
Is it watching us as we leave?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
What kind of, can I pick up on any insights from its expression?
Let's see. He seems impatient. Impatient, okay. Like almost like he's tapping his foot. Or, okay. Drumming his fingers, that kind of thing.
Yeah. I just turn to the group, I say, I think we should make haste.
Agreed, I say, and I smile towards the man I have been hunting.
I agree as well. Let us make haste.
Very well. Well, then I assume you all fall in line behind Brother Mark Maple as he begins to lead you all down this craggy, broken, windswept, horrific plateau of tumbled rock. As you descend, the dust becomes thicker. The rubble becomes more common. Your footing becomes more unstable. And peppered now amongst the rock that originally looks mostly like basalt, occasional granite, that sort of thing, you now start to see little shards of obsidian are everywhere, almost like dust. And that also seems to be coating it starts to get into your skin. Every time you rub your face, you'll come away with scratches. Eventually, you can end up getting into your eyes and your hair and your ears. And in a matter of within your first hour of descent, you're all hellishly uncomfortable as you follow Brother Mark Maple. I am going to roll a dexterity for your men, and everybody else, you will have to roll me your own dexterity rolls.
Okay.
Eleven under 14.
Okay, that succeeds.
13.
8 under 14.
Okay, that Virgil succeeds. Fintan? Or Finot? No, I'm doing it. Finot?
Oh yeah, I rolled an 8.
You're fine.
I actually do not succeed. My dexterity is 12.
Oh, you
one over.
Oh, so you fail. You fail. Okay. Not all of your men make it either. Essentially, what ends up happening though is during one particularly difficult descent, as you are basically half walking, half climbing down this particularly loose promontory of rocks and rubble, one of your men slips his handhold, and he goes tumbling down the hill, taking you, Inquisitor, with him. You end up on the bottom of the hill, taking 2 points of damage, scuffed and bruised, with a man in bronze plate mail lying on top of you, groaning.
Yes, I fall with as much grace as I can. I am actually used to tumbling down things, although it's not something I do often. Although it still hurts, and I do get up, I frown, and then I go to assist him getting up, going, come, friend.
All right, very well. Sorry about that, sir. Sorry about that. Lost my footing, sir. But the rest of you can all make your descent down to the bottom of this plateau, where the plateau meets this plain.
Yes,
looking
I
back
four
up
under
over,
12.
Oh, you made it too, right? Sorry, forgot to ask Dante.
No,
but yes, sorry, you made it fine. And your bird has no trouble.
Yes, I occasionally call him down if he wants to. I mean,
would prefer to stay on your arm or your shoulder. In fact, you might even think that he would prefer to be hooded.
Yes, I whisper to him that calming words, and I do bring out the hood for him and
very well.
Put it on.
Then he goes back to being his normal self, unperturbed by his surroundings, which actually might even calm you slightly.
Mm.
As I said, looking back up the plateau, the descent that you have just made, you are shocked to realize that that sort of crevice that you had climbed down, that took you almost a half an hour to climb down, was actually, appears now to be the cracked and broken socket of some gigantic skull.
From a, possibly an actual being, or from a statue?
Who could carve something that large? It's the size of a mountain, Dante. It's the skull the size of a mountain.
What titans must have roamed this land?
Can I make a religion check?
Sure, you could make a religion check.
Okay. I rolled a 4 on a 17.
Okay, what do you think this means?
My inclination is to wonder at the ancient stories of dead gods from Terragastia. Or dead titans, perhaps, that were once worshipped as gods.
Yes, perhaps dead titan. Could very well be something like that, maybe. A dead titan.
Yeah, I turn to the group and I say, behold, perhaps a titan, a god, some being of immense power, dead. The things in this multiverse are not what they appear.
I dust some of the obsidian off from my falcon, and I say, yes, truly, to meet something like this, I wonder if these beings actually exist still.
How wonderfully irrelevant, Finnet. How wonderfully irrelevant. If you could quit gawking at every pretty trinket you see or bit of landscape and focus on where you're going, hopefully we will get out of the situation quicker.
Now, speaking about where you are going, you gentlemen now have a choice that you will need to make. You, one way or another, will have to cross these great and dusty plains, but you sort of have a direction to pick. If you want to go straight ahead towards the direct direction the devil pointed, directly towards those mountains in the far distance, you will be crossing what appears to be, in the distance at least, a field of volcanic activity. You see gouts of exploding lava, and in some cases, impossibly, you see what appears to be almost snakes of lava that shoot from one hole and land in another crater across the plain somehow. Impossible. It's impossible, but you're seeing it here now. That's the direct path. If you were to cheat more to the right, let's say, which would be more towards, I guess, the south, that would lead you more in the direction of those large milling shapes and the winged figures flying over top of them. Although, I will say, at this point, during your descent, Milton, you definitely caught a sign of that dragon once again. You definitely saw it this time.
So, it is here. Dragons are here.
Seems to be.
I wonder what that means.
Indeed. And again, if you cheat... and just to finish, if you were to cheat to the left of going straight through this volcanic area, it appears that that would lead you more towards some sort of strange forest? Some kind of strange metallic looking forest. So you have three choices which way you want to go. Straight through, slightly to the left, slightly to the right.
Yeah,
you don't have to decide just yet, but those are your choices as you are faced with this scene. What do you guys do?
Well, I turn to the druid, Mark Maple, and I say, Druid, can you take animal form?
I can.
Can you fly?
I can.
Can you scout the proper direction?
I can, but I won't. I am not leaving the protection of this group. I do not know where we have come, but I know enough to know that I am not safe on my own, and neither are any of you.
Well,
it appears as though there's more than one coward in this group.
So be it. That doesn't faze him at all.
I step forward and give Pickett a look, and then I turn to Sir Milton. Sir Milton, what do you think
which way forward would be perhaps the best to take.
I believe that we shall face our fears straight ahead. I believe that we should take them on. That lava does look very, very dangerous, but at least we know what it is. At least we see the danger in front of us. We do not know what awaits in that forest, and those large beings, we have no way of knowing whether or not they will decide that we are lunch. So I would rather pick an adversary that I can see, even if it happens to be molten rock.
Do the wizards agree?
I think to myself that I, on my many hunting trips, never ventured in such a rough hellscape. But I nod hesitantly, and I say, yes, I'm not sure any of the alternatives are better than the others for now. And I look out and I see these fiery snakes leaping between the craters. Fine, let's venture this way.
Finn just says, so be it.
I nod.
Then is that the direction you gentlemen start to turn?
Yes, I begin moving forwards. And also at this point, I put away my blade of shining sun. Because I believe, looking at what's ahead of us, I would be very surprised if it wasn't very effective against beings made of fire. Instead, I shall have my scourge at the ready.
Very well. Very well.
And I shall ready my scroll of protection from fire. I do not know when I wish to actually use it, but I'm sure that the time will come, and it will come quite quickly.
Very well. All right, so, and as, actually, as you turn and take your first few steps in that direction towards these fiery fields, coming from the top of the hill, you can hear the loud, booming report of a signal horn that echoes across the fields. Once, twice, and then from the fields to the south, those great milling armies, perhaps, you hear shouts coming in your direction. What do you do?
Let's try and make haste.
What does that mean? Does that mean you run?
Finn says, I think we should be moving. Quickly.
I agree. Men, forwards, quickly as possible.
Very well. Yes. Then that means you are all running, which means you have to make me dexterity checks to avoid taking damage.
Okay. I rolled a 9 on 14.
Okay, you don't take damage.
I rolled a 1 on 14.
Excellent. You do exceptionally well.
I rolled a 12 on 12.
Okay, you're fine.
And, I rolled a...
Go ahead.
13 on 12.
Huh. Alright, so you failed. You failed. Alright, so you will take... you will take 1 point of damage. Basically, you end up, as you are running to, basically away from this area, from the army that's now going to be pursuing you, apparently, you end up, slipping and jamming your elbow into, like, a spiky rock as you slip, and it comes away bloody.
Ah! And I try to get up and catch up.
Yeah, that's fine. You are running. Eventually, those sounds fade. And you don't hear them in pursuit, but as you look around, you appear to be short two men. Somewhere along the line, they fell behind. What do you do? Do you leave them? Do you go back?
I look backwards towards the men, but I cannot see them.
You aren't even in the lava fields yet, although you are starting to see and smell, you know, the volcanic activity, and you will see sort of little pits of, you know, molten rock here and there, but you are not even amongst the explosions yet. These were just running across the plains. Do you want to go back for them, or is it do you still run?
But But I cannot just leave them behind. That is not who I am. No, I shall go back. You move on ahead. I will catch up with you, I say as I start to make it back.
So Milton is leaving on his own. Does that mean the rest of you are moving on, or is someone going with him?
Fool, we need to keep moving forward.
All right, so I assume Pickett's moving forward. What about Dante and Virgil?
I frown a little, and I remark to some of the men, at least two of them, go with Milton. Sir Milton, look for them, but if they have fallen, we must look after the group. Be careful.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. All right, well, two men will break off, and they'll go with you, Sir Milton. The easiest way we'll do to resolve this is just give me two intelligence rolls.
All right, I shall do just that.
And in the meantime, the rest of you are running, right?
Yes.
You're running on, so.
13 mm-hmm. on 13 and 1 on 13.
Okay, excellent. Excellent. All right, so what I'll say is that you do find both your men. The one man you find injured, he has fallen and twisted his ankle, so he is basically like half moving now. He's at half speed, but is basically still trying to make as much haste as he can. Your men end up running into him as he was scrambling over some rocks. The second man you also find on your one, and he appears to have fallen into a crevasse and broken his neck. He did not survive that fall, or maybe he survived it, but the strange infernal insects that are crawling and biting him now, perhaps they finished him.
I look at that scene with horror, but then I look to the man I did find, and I try to judge, would I need to give this man healing, or perhaps apply an ointment in order for him to be able to move at the same speed as us?
Yes, he would need to be healed to move at your speed.
Yes.
Is that something you want to take the time to do?
It would take, yes. I'm not going to leave anyone behind here. I will, in fact, utilize one of my Kyokton's ointments and mm-hmm. apply it on him.
How long does that take?
It takes... Mm-hmm. I don't know if it says the Sovereign Salve.
I think it takes 10 minutes to apply. It may not say.
Is it the same? It doesn't say here. Does it say anything about like healing? Is that healing is?
It would actually be under the description. If it doesn't say, we're gonna say you can't do it immediately. It's not like you know mm-hmm. one round and you're done. It's he's got to take off his boot and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
What do you want the other men to do? Are they standing nearby or do you want to send them back while you treat this man?
We shall move together. So
okay, so they're staying with you.
I will ask them to stay here as I heal. All right.
So I am just gonna. Friend. So then, just roll me luck, and actually, your men also have a luck score, but their luck score is the total of however many numbers they have left. So their luck is currently we lost one, right? So it's now 9. Not so good. Anyway, what did you roll, Milton?
I'm supposed to roll 3d6s, right?
No, well, you already rolled that, right? So right. Now you're trying to roll under. I think your luck was a 12.
12. And I roll 8.
Okay. Good. What I will say is, all right, so you're working as diligently as you can. You basically find yourself back in sort of wartime thinking. You know what I mean? Where there's a job to be done and you're just ignoring all other things and focusing on the mission. And the mission right now is to heal this man's leg. So you get his boot off, you apply this ointment, the curative magics begin to take hold. And that is when your men start to panic. And they look around and start to point. And all around you, at least 3 different sides, you now see a veritable army of those desiccated creatures that you fought in Finot's laboratory. But there are hundreds of them, thousands maybe, behind them, all coming in your direction, all screaming and moaning. But your luck was good enough that you managed to heal this man's leg before they're on you. What do you do?
Then we must move now. I pull up my amulet of versus undead, and I try to keep them at bay.
Okay, okay. Well, that amulet will actually keep them at bay, so you just owe me one more dexterity roll.
All right. 18 on 14.
Okay, so you fail. And you... Actually, you will only take 1 point of damage as well. As you and your men basically run away from this army of lemures, and you can catch up with the rest of the group.
And those wretched beings that make up that army, could they perhaps be some of the lost souls who vanished on the Bishop's Crusade? Is this how they are being punished? Is this where they disappeared to?
Indeed. Perhaps indeed.
For the rest of you, we are going to resolve this whole scene just with a luck roll. So, everybody give me their luck to traverse the fiery fields.
Just before that, would it be beneficial if I cast Endure Heat on myself, or would it probably be if it's not needed, I won't cast it?
I think Endure Heat would make your, make you more comfortable here in the, I was trying to estimate what I thought the temperature of hell would be, and I think it's probably between 100 and 110 degrees Fahrenheit, which would put it between, 40 and 45 Celsius for you guys.
Wow, that's hot.
So yeah, it's hot. It's definitely hot. Like, you can survive it, but you would need, actually, really, also, I was supposed to make you make endurance rolls too, but we'll do those next. First things first is the luck roll to get through the fire.
Very well.
Then scroll of protection from fire. Is that something that also?
If you want to use that, I'll just tell you this in a metagame kind of way. If you use that, you won't need to make a luck roll.
Mm. And that actually is applicable for everyone in a sphere around me, right?
You'd have to read the description. I'm not exactly sure.
Which spell is that?
They took those out of third edition. They're in second edition. The scrolls of protection.
Yeah, protection extends to a 30-foot diameter sphere centered on the reader. All in this area are able to withstand flame and heat of the hottest type, even of magical and elemental nature. The protection lasts 1d4 plus 4 turns.
Okay.
Oh, nice. 1d4 plus 4
Then I shall read that and utilize that, because
excellent.
This feels like a good time.
Yes.
Yes, yes. Actually, very, 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 a very, very excellent use of your scroll. So Sir Milton pulls out this holy scroll, begins to read a litany in Solarian, which is essentially your world's Latin. And at the activation of this scroll, the scroll immediately flashes in golden fire and turns to dust. But that light extends in a 30-foot radius around Milton, who is the reader, encapsulating all of you in an envelope of protective magic, which will allow you to traverse this fiery field without taking any damage. Which was good, because sooner or later somebody was going to get hit with lava, and that would not have been fun. Go ahead.
Are we being pursued by the mirrors?
You guys were moving at a run speed, so you can outpace them at a run speed.
Okay.
You'll be fine. You'll be fine at this case. It was only Milton, and only because he went back.
Okay.
So you guys are fine for now. And what we'll say is, while your trip through these fiery fields are harrowing, nerve-wracking, and more than once you find yourself peeling away strips of molten rock that have splattered on your skin, the magic of Milton's scroll protects you from that damage.
How long do we get on that now? Did you roll for
I didn't roll, but it will be enough. I know that that's going to be enough to get you through the fields, even if you roll minimum. You'll be fine. So you guys can make it through without losing any more of your number.
Wonderful. Nice. I stick close to Milton and I give him a nod of good thinking, brother. Good thinking.
I nod back.
Very well done, Milton. Very well done. Mm-hmm. So as you make your way across the fields, leaving this forest now to your far left, and what looks like now scarring the the plains is what actually looks like a literal scar. The river, so to speak, doesn't look like it's been eroded from the rock so much as just carved in by some kind of haphazard, dull knife that now is filling with some strange bloody water. And you can see that in the distance there are two armies on opposite sides of this scar-like river that are attacking each other and basically creating a bridge of bodies that they then continue to assault each other on top of. Fortunately, that looks like a good mile or two in the distance, and you do not need to worry about avoiding that. But that is something that you would see. But as you make your way out of these fiery fields, it is actually Sir Milton who would be the first to recognize the smell that you encounter as you progress. You encounter the cloying, metallic odor of masses of clotting blood. This takes you back. This smells of war, doesn't it?
It does. It does. To all those battles that I saw. All those battles that we fought.
But one in particular, doesn't it?
Yes.
The Battle of Blood Rain, when it rained blood.
Yes, that was the worst of them.
It smells like that day. It smells just like that. Takes you back to that moment. Something bloody is before you. What do you do?
I look to the sky briefly, trying to find her.
Milton.
But she's not there.
Hmm.
I move ahead. Steel myself for what we're about to face.
Mm. Oh, very well. So as you gentlemen begin your to progress following now Milton, it is worth noting that all throughout this time, you have seen and heard the reports of these fireballs that seem to explode randomly all across the plains. But you do on occasion see one explode nearby. And at this point, you actually even manage to see one explode a little too uncomfortably close to you. To the point where the sound and the sweep of the rushing winds almost rushes like a stampede across the plains. But you can see where this fireball has actually exploded. Now you actually realize where all this obsidian is coming from. For as the fireball explodes, it then starts to rain shards of black, spiky obsidian all around where it exploded. And you realize that that now is what has coated this land with these shards of sharp glass-like rock.
Hmm.
Lord Finnet, as you are walking along, as you are wont to do, you suddenly find yourself with a small pang of hunger. What do you do?
I reach into my haversack and I pull out a little wooden spoon and I just take almost a pantomime bite from it. And then I put the spoon back into my haversack.
Well, I'm sorry to inform you, Lord Pickett, but your heart sinks as you place your hand into the pocket of your haversack and find it empty.
Ugh.
Your haversack is empty. All the pockets are empty.
I upend it and I start shaking it towards the ground.
It's filled with dust and nothing else.
No.
What
is this? My haversack. It's a Heward's handy haversack. But it's empty now. I had water and my magic spoon and scrolls.
No.
Everything.
I look through my own equipment. Is everything there?
Everything of yours is there, yeah.
Huh. I bring out the little pouch of a little pouch, and I reach into it to see if I feel furry objects, as I usually do when reaching into that particular pouch.
You do feel a furry object in there, although it feels a little different somehow, maybe a little colder, perhaps. It's tough to tell. Do you pull an object out?
Now, I was merely wondering if there was some sort of severed connection of magics, really.
It's possible. Seems that Finn's experiencing something.
I'm curious now, though. It feels different. What? I try to pull it out, and I throw it on the ground in front of me.
All right. Well, I assume we're talking about your bag of tricks, yes?
Yes.
All right. Do you want to roll that die 8 for me?
Sorry? A die, yes.
Roll the die 8 to determine what animal comes out.
Right. 5.
Which is?
A giant lynx, normally.
Alright, so you reach your hand into this pouch and you feel a small furry ball inside that you know that that if you throw that, it will transform into an animal. And so you do so. You pull this small furry ball out of this pouch, toss it a few feet away, and indeed it does take the form of a giant lynx, a giant hunting cat. However, there's something different about the creature. Its fur is black with purple and green stripes, and it's covered in spines, and its fangs seem to drip like some kind of strange venom. And it looks at you, flicking its tail, swishing it around, waiting for your orders, with infernal-looking eyes.
I gulp, and I think to myself, it seems to be still under my control.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems that not all sort of barriers have been cut between magic items. And I look to the others to see how they were reacting to this.
Mm. What are the others doing when this happens?
I raise an eyebrow and remark, is there any point to what you're doing, wizard?
Oh, no, just calling forth a servant. I turn to Finn, I don't know. My equipment seems to work just fine.
Okay, great. I am going to try and get the demonic lynx that I've conjured back into the bag.
All right, you can do so, but something is different. Something is, in fact, different. So what I need you to do is go ahead and make me a spellcraft roll, but do so at a minus 5.
Oh, minus 5. Right, I'm going to roll for that. I get a 4.
All right. That still succeeds. So that this creature, this demonic lynx, seems to begrudgingly, almost belligerently, obey your commands and returns itself leaping back into your bag of tricks.
Right, as the creature disappears back into the bag, I draw a small sigh of relief. I somehow didn't expect even that bag to be so overridden. Everything really is different here. It's fascinating. I have to stop my hand from immediately pulling out something else and see what more would come out. But I'm not sure if I would be able to control it.
Can I make a spellcraft check?
You sure can.
Ugh, no, I failed. So
you failed. Yeah, you're not exactly sure. You're not exactly sure. You know that magic must be altered somehow on the planes, though what is altered and how, you're not sure.
Well, I'm sort of panicking and I'm cursing in Inferno because I speak to Dante in Inferno so the others don't know. But I say, my spellbook was in there. Now all I have is what I have memorized. Damn!
I try to think to myself, is there any way that such an item could be reconnected with our world?
You can make a spellcraft roll.
Let's see. That's 8 under 14.
Okay. What I will say is that, yes, in theory it should be possible to somehow either reconnect or use some kind of bridging item somehow to make magic function, quote unquote, the way it should, or at least the way it does where it's back home or whatever. But as to what that could be, you have no idea.
Yeah.
In theory, it's possible, but you don't know how to do it.
It should be possible somehow to bridge it back to the location or where your items are supposed to be. I'm not quite sure how. Maybe that's another thing we could ask the witch once we get there.
Yes.
Mm. Well, very well. But as you approach, you start to see now the source of the smell, Sir Milton. Before you, impossibly, is a river of blood. A river that looks to be hundreds of feet across. But it stands between you and those mountains.
It is blocking our path.
Was I a fool to seek my own redemption through the pursuit of another lost soul? As that quest has ultimately dragged me to the very hells themselves, how could I ever be certain? I can't possibly be sure of anything since arriving to this infernal place. Things were all finally starting to make sense again, and now? Now? Again, my sword has fallen silent, and once more I have nothing but my own tainted heart to guide me, which I must now still somehow use to navigate through this hellish realm, with likely much more bloodshed before me yet. Blood there before us, and possibly a river of blood. Ever vivid remain the memories of my experiences at the Battle of Blood Rain, where the skies opened up all about me as armies of dragons above shed torrents of their lifeblood down. Down, down upon that wretched scarlet beach. Hurst mixed in too among all those countless droplets.
Milton, please.
Yet even that terrible memory pales in comparison to this. For that beach was just the place I lost her. Could it be possible I've actually been brought to the hellish place I lost her to? Yet before me, and between me and those answers, stretches a river of blood. Blood. Just more blood to wade through. This episode features music from the enhanced soundtrack of the classic video game Planescape Torment.
Created by Black Isle Studios and provided courtesy of the brilliant folks at Beamdog.
Visit beamdog.com to access digital downloads of more classic RPG video games, remastered gaming soundtracks, and other great role-playing resources.
This episode of To Beator and Back features music from
Halgrath,
off the album The Whole Path of War and Acceptance,
Metatron Omega,
off the albums Sanctum, Gnosis Day, and Illuminatio,
Atrium Carceri,
off the album Codex,
Flowers for Body Snatchers,
off the album Aoki Gahara,
and made available courtesy of their label Cryo Chamber. Visit cryochamber.bandcamp.com for more dark ambient.
Various music and Foley content used in this program has been made available for use under the Creative Commons by Attribution 3.0 license. But extra special thanks is due to Kevin McLeod of Incompetech, David Feslian at feslianstudios.com, and the many inspired folks over at zapsplat.com and freesound.org. The Black Spire RPG campaign episodes simply would not be possible without the use of these resources.
If you're curious for more, find Black Spire Studios on Facebook or visit Robert Randall's site, therelaquem.com, a blog about art and magic, comics and gaming, and how they all tie together. For more information concerning his various projects, you can follow him on Twitter at therelaquem and his actual play podcast at Black Spire Pod.
And releasing on the weeks opposite to Black Spire, you can hear Rob and Aaron on their other podcast, Adventure Hook. But each episode, these two comic book pros develop a random story idea for game masters to incorporate into their own RPGs. Find Adventure Hook on Facebook and Twitter, and also be sure to follow Aaron using his handle at AllManCampbell. And be sure to submit new ideas for their random D20 tables using the hashtag NewAdventureHook.
And of course, be sure to visit redmoonroleplaying.com to listen to more dark actual play RPG adventure,
including such games as Cult Divinity Lost,
The Curse of Strahd,
Vampire the Masquerade, and a lot of other games and one-shots.